Good morning. Well, the first thing I'd like to do is to thank everybody that's helped us put this on. As you saw in the movie, I think at the time we may have had 45,000 or so people working with Berkshire, with 12.8 at headquarters. We're probably up to about 60,000 now, and we still have 12.8. And they take care of putting on this whole meeting. We get help from people in internal audit, and we get terrific help from the people at all of our companies who work very hard to put on the exhibits, and we hope that you not only visit them but patronize them, and we'll give you ample time to do that. As you can see, I enlisted my family for the movie, and I want to thank them. I want to particularly thank Kelly Muchmore and Mark Hamburg for their work in putting this on. It's a real project. A lot of companies have a whole department that does this, and at Berkshire, Kelly processes 25,000 requests for tickets and coordinates everything with exhibitors, and it's a fabulous job. Now, we'll follow our usual routine. We do have a surprise at 11:45. It's not that Charlie's going to say anything. That would be a big surprise. But we'll have the small surprise for 11:45. The plan is to go through the business part of the meeting here in just a second, and we'll run from 9:30 to 12. Then after conducting the business meeting, we'll take your questions. We'll go around the room. We have 10 stations. I guess we'll probably only be using 8 stations in this room, and we have microphones every place that the 8 stations will see, and you can step up to those. And we'll just keep answering questions. Then we'll break at 12 o'clock, and there will be food available down below where you can also purchase things from us. And we'll reconvene about 12:45, and then we'll stay until 3:30, and we'll try and answer whatever questions you have. And then we will have to cut it off at 3:30. We had about the same number of ticket requests as in the past, but we had a different mix this year. We, as most of you know, we had to change the venue and the time because Exarban is winding down. And so there's a little different rhythm to this meeting. A much higher percentage of our tickets than usual were requested by people from Omaha. And of course, you've heard me say before that we're a little suspicious of these figures because we know that a lot of people claim to be from Omaha that aren't for status reasons, and so we can't really give you the geographical breakdown we normally would. I'd like to introduce first our directors, and then we'll proceed into the formal business of the meeting. On my left here is the ever-animated Charlie Munger, our vice chairman. And if the other directors will stand up as I announce their names, we have the better voice in the movie, my wife, Susan Buffett. Susie? We have Howard Buffett. You can see we find these names in the phone book. I mean, and Kim Chase. Kim? Walter Scott, the star of How to Be a Jillionaire. And Ron Olson. Ron? Okay, we'll now take on the formal part of the meeting. Ryan set a new record, I think. 5 minutes, 38.4, but with the 4-minute mile has always been our ambition on this. So I will go through this, and then we'll get to the questions. The meeting will now come to order. I'm Warren Buffett, Chairman of the Board of Directors of this company. I welcome you to this 2000 Annual Meeting of Shareholders. I've introduced the directors. Also with us today are partners in the firm of Deloitte & Touche, our auditors. They are available to respond to appropriate questions you might have concerning their firm's audit of the accounts of Berkshire. Mr. Forrest Crutter, Secretary of Berkshire. He will make a written record of the proceedings. Ms. Becky Amick has been appointed Inspector of Elections at this meeting. She will certify to the count of votes cast in the election for directors. The named proxy holders for this meeting are Walter Scott Jr. and Mark Dig Hamburg. Does the Secretary have a report of the number of Berkshire shares outstanding entitled to vote and represented at the meeting?
I do. Yes, I do. As indicated in the proxy statement that accompanied the notice of this meeting that was sent by first-class mail to all shareholders of record on March 3, 2000, being the record date for this meeting, there are 1,341,174 shares of Class A Berkshire Hathaway common stock outstanding, with each share entitled to one vote on motions considered at the meeting, and 5,385,320 shares of Class B Berkshire Hathaway common stock outstanding, with each share entitled to 1/200th of one vote on motions considered at the meeting. Of that number, 1,116,151 Class A shares and 4,342,959 Class B shares are represented at this meeting by proxies returned through Thursday evening, April 27.
Thank you. That number represents a quorum, and we will therefore directly proceed with the meeting. The first order of business will be a reading of the minutes of the last meeting of shareholders. I recognize Mr. Walter Scott, Jr., who will place a motion before the meeting.
I move that the reading of the minutes of the last meeting of the shareholders be dispensed with.
Do I hear a second? The motion has been moved and seconded. Are there any comments or questions? We will vote on this question by voice vote. All those in favor say aye. Opposed? You can signify by saying I'm leaving. The motion is carried. The one item of business of this meeting is to elect directors. If a shareholder is present who wishes to withdraw a proxy previously sent in and vote in person on the election of directors, he or she may do so. Also, if any shareholder that is present has not turned in a proxy and desires a ballot in order to vote in person, you may do so. If you wish to do this, please identify yourself to the meeting officials in the aisle who will furnish a ballot for you. Would those persons desiring ballots please identify themselves so that we may distribute them? I now recognize Mr. Walter Scott, Jr. to place a motion before the meeting with respect to election of directors.
I move that Warren E. Buffett, Susan T. Buffett, Howard G. Buffett, Malcolm G. Chase, Charles T. Munger, Ronald L. Olson, and Walter Scott, Jr. be elected as directors.
Is there a second? It's been moved and seconded that Warren E. Buffett, Susan T. Buffett, Howard G. Buffett, Malcolm G. Chase, Charles T. Munger, Ronald L. Olson, and Walter Scott, Jr. be elected as directors. Are there any other nominations? Is there any discussion? The nominations are ready to be acted upon. If there are any shareholders voting in person, they should now mark their ballots on the election of directors and allow the ballots to be delivered to the Inspector of Election. Would the proxy holders please also submit to the Inspector of Elections a ballot on the election of directors voting the proxies in accordance with the instructions they have received. Ms. Amick, when you are ready, you may give your report.
My report is ready. The ballot of the proxy holders in response to proxies that were received through last Thursday evening cast not less than 1,136,497 votes for each nominee. That number far exceeds a majority of the number of the total votes related to all Class A and Class B shares outstanding. The certification required by Delaware law of the precise count of the votes, including the additional votes to be cast by the proxy holders in response to proxies delivered at this meeting, as well as those cast in person at this meeting, if any, will be given to the Secretary to be placed with the minutes of this meeting.
Thank you, Becky. Warren E. Buffett, Susan T. Buffett, Howard G. Buffett, Malcolm G. Chase, Charles T. Munger, Ronald L. Olson, and Walter Scott, Jr. have been elected as directors. Does anyone have any further business to come before this meeting before we adjourn? If not, I recognize Mr. Walter Scott, Jr. to place a motion before the meeting.
I move that this meeting be adjourned.
Is there a second? A motion to adjourn has been made and seconded. We will vote by voice. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor say aye. All opposed, no. This meeting's adjourned. Thank you. We will advise Guinness of those results, and maybe we'll get in the book. Just want to make one more announcement, and then we'll start in on the questions with Area 1, which I believe will be right over here. About I think about 3,500 of you are attending the ball game tonight. You know what you're supposed to do, incidentally. And we've in the past we've had some traffic jams at where the interstate goes off into 13th Street. So the police, who are wonderfully cooperative throughout this whole weekend in many ways, are going to do their darndest to make sure that we don't have much of a jam. But if those of you who are attending the game would like to go a little early, that will probably be quite helpful. And I might say that we have probably got, well, we think it's probably the best zoo in the world here, thanks in very large part to our director, Walter Scott, and his wife, Sue, who have really turned our zoo into a huge attraction, draws well over 1 million people a year. It's right adjacent to the ballpark. So if you get on a little early and you want to go to the zoo, and then you won't even have to move your car, you can come over to the ballpark. And there's also a food there, and we serve Coca-Cola products. And if you don't all try to come at 6:45, it will be a help to us. I will be pitching at 7:05, but my fastball will arrive at the plate almost instantaneously with the moment that it leaves my hand. So unless you're there, you'll miss it. And so with that, let's start in area one, and we will go around, and feel free to ask any questions. You might identify yourself and where you're from before asking your question. Area one.
Good morning, Mr. Buffett and Mr. Munger. My name is Steve Yates. I'm from Chicago. I'm a Berkshire shareholder, and this is my sixth year coming to this meeting. I'd like to thank you for all your time and advice through the years. It's been great. I'd also like to thank all those wonderful people who sold Berkshire this year for giving us an opportunity to purchase more of the world's greatest company for dirt cheap prices.
We will convey your thanks.
I own another stock which sells for 4 times current trailing earnings. Every quarter we get a report. Earnings go up, sales go up, cash flow goes up, the equity base expands, they gain market share, and the stock goes down. The company has a 60% 5-year annualized growth rate and sells at 4 times earnings. I have two related questions. First, is this a growth stock or a value stock? And could you please give us your definitions of these terms? Second, the company sells recreational vehicles. Demographic trends in the recreation and leisure areas, RVs, cruise lines, golf equipment, etc., seem to be quite good. Do you see any opportunities for Berkshire here? Thanks.
Well, the question about growth and value, we've addressed in past annual reports, but they are not two distinct categories of business. Every business is worth the present. If you knew what it was going to be able to disgorge in cash between now and Judgment Day, you could come to a precise figure as to what it is worth today. Now, elements of that can be the ability to use additional capital at good rates. And most growth companies that are characterized as growth companies have that as a characteristic. But there is no distinction in our minds between growth and value. Every business we look at as being a value proposition. The potential for growth and the likelihood of good economics being attached to that growth are part of the equation in evaluation. But they're all value decisions. A company that pays no dividends, growing 100% a year, you know, is losing money now. That's a value decision. You have to decide how much value you're going to get. Actually, it's very simple. The first investment primer, when would you guess it was written? The first investment primer that I know of, and it was pretty good advice, was delivered in about 600 B.C., by Aesop. And Aesop, you'll remember, said, a bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. Now, incidentally, Aesop did not know it was 600 B.C. He was smart, but he wasn't that smart. Now, Aesop was onto something, but he didn't finish it, because there's a couple of other questions that go along with that. But it is an investment equation. A bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. He forgot to say exactly when you were going to get the two in the, from the bush, and he forgot to say what interest rates were that you had to measure this against. But if he'd given those two factors, he would have defined investment for the next 2,600 years, because a bird in the hand is, you know, you will trade a bird in the hand, which is investing. You lay out cash today, and then the question is, as an investment decision, you have to evaluate how many birds are in the bush. You may think there are two birds in the bush or three birds in the bush, and you have to decide when they're going to come out and when you're going to acquire them. Now, if interest rates are 5% and you're going to get two birds from the bush in 5 years, we'll say, versus one now, two birds in the bush are much better than a bird in the hand now. So you want to trade your bird in the hand and say, I'll take two birds in the bush, because if you're going to get them in 5 years, that's roughly 14% compounded annually, and interest rates are only 5%. But if interest rates were 20%, you would decline to take two birds in the bush 5 years from now. You would say that's not good enough, because at 20%, if I just keep this bird in my hand and compound it, I'll have more birds than two birds in the bush in 5 years. Now, what's all that got to do with growth? Well, usually growth people associate with a lot more birds in the bush, but you still have to decide when you're going to get them. And you have to measure that against interest rates, and you have to measure it against other bushes and other, other equations. And that's all investing is. It's a value decision based on, you know, what it is worth, how many birds are in that bush, when you're going to get them, and what interest rates are. Now, if you pay $500 billion, and when we buy a stock, we always think in terms of buying the whole enterprise, because it enables us to think as businessmen rather than as stock speculators. So let's just take a company that has marvelous prospects, is paying you nothing now, and you buy it at a valuation of $500 billion. Now, if you feel that 10% is the appropriate rate of return, and you can pick your figure, that means that if it pays you nothing this year, but starts paying next year, it has to be able to pay you $55 billion in perpetuity each year. But if it's not going to pay until the third year, then it has to pay you $60.5 billion in perpetuity, to justify the present price. Every year that you wait to take a bird out of the bush means that you have to take out more birds. It's that simple. And I question in my mind whether people who pay $500 billion implicitly for a business by buying 10 shares of stock at some price are really thinking of the mathematics implicit in what they are doing. To deliver, let's just assume that there's only going to be a one-year delay before the business starts paying out to you, and you want to get a 10% return, and you pay $500 billion. That means $55 billion of cash that they have to be able to disgorge to you year after year after year. To do that, they have to make perhaps $80 billion or close to it pre-tax. Now, you might look around at the universe of businesses in this world and see how many are earning $80 billion pre-tax, or 70, or 60, or 50, or 40, or 30, and you won't find any. So it requires a rather extraordinary change in profitability to give you enough birds out of that particular bush to make it worthwhile to give up the one that you have in your hand. The second part of your question about whether we'd be willing to buy a wonderful business at four times earnings, I think I could get even Charlie interested in that. But let's hear it from Charlie.
I'd like to know what that is.
He was hoping you would ask that, the fellow that's got all his net worth in this stock and who has a captive audience. Tell us what it is. You got to tell us. We're begging you.
You want the name of the company?
We want the name of the company. We're okay. Dying to get the name. Wait till I get my pencil out.
Okay. It's called National RV, and it's based in California, and they sell recreational vehicles.
Okay. Well, you've got a crowd of people who have birds in the hand, and we will see what they do in terms of National RV. Charlie, do you have anything further on growth and value, et cetera? Watch him carefully, folks.
Well, I agree that all intelligent investing is value investing. You have to acquire more than you really pay for, and that's a value judgment. But you can look for more than you're paying for in a lot of different ways. You can use filters to sift the investment universe. And if you stick with stocks that can't possibly be wonderful to just put away in your safe deposit box for 40 years, but are underpriced, then you have to keep moving around all the time. As they get closer to what you think the real value is, you have to sell them and then find others. And so it's an active kind of investing. The investing where you find a few great companies and just sit on your ass because you've correctly predicted the future, that is what it's very nice to be good at.
The movie was G-rated, even though.
Is that it, Charlie?
Okay, we will move to area two.
Good morning, gentlemen. Wayne Peters. And where I come from, our ladies are referred to as birds. And I'm sure I know a lot that would trade one for in the hand for two in the bush, irrespective of the interest rate. I have two small questions. Firstly, with the speculation, and some would say rampant speculation in the high-tech and internet arenas, could you share your views on the potential fallout from this speculation for the general economy? And secondly, how long did it actually take you to perfect that curveball? And are we going to see it tonight?
I don't think I want to give anything away about my pitches tonight. Ernie Banks may be in the audience. I know he's in town, and I just can't afford to do that. But you'll see it tonight, and you can describe it any way you'd like. The question about the high-tech stocks and possible fallout. Anytime there have been real bursts of speculation in the market, you know, that it does get corrected eventually. Ben Graham was right when he said that in the short run it's a voting machine, in the long run it's a weighing machine. Sooner or later, the amount of cash that a business can disgorge in the future governs the value it has, that the stock commands in the market. But it can take a long time. And I mean, it's a very interesting proposition. For example, if you take a company that in the end never makes any money, but the trade changes hands representing a valuation of $10 or $20 billion for some time, there's no wealth created. There's a tremendous amount of wealth transferred. And I think you will see, when we look back on this era, you will see this as a period of enormous amounts of wealth transfer. But in the end, the only wealth creation comes about through what the business creates. There's no magic to it. If a company that's not worth anything sells for $20 billion, and 5% of it changes hands, somebody takes $1 billion from somebody else. But investors as a whole gain nothing. They all feel richer. It's a very interesting phenomenon. But they can't be richer except as a group, unless the company makes them richer. And it's the same principle as a chain letter. I mean, if you're very early on a chain letter, you can make money. There's no money created by chain letters. In fact, there's the frictional cost of envelopes and postage and that sort of thing. So the net, there's some money destroyed a little bit. And there's money destroyed by the frictional costs of trading and investing. That comes out of investors' pockets. But the manias that periodically take place, and not just in stocks, We had a similar mania. Well, I'm not necessarily similar. We certainly had a mania in farmland here in Nebraska 20 years ago, and land which couldn't produce, we'll say, more than $70 or $80 an acre would sell for $2,000 an acre at times when interest rates were 10%. Well, that math will kill you. And it killed the people who bought it at those prices, and it killed a great many banks here in Nebraska who lent based on that sort of thing. But while it was going on, everybody thought it was wonderful because every farm was selling for more than the similar farm had sold for a month earlier. And it was momentum investing in farmland. And in the end, valuation does count, but it can go on a long time. And when you get a huge number of participants playing with ever increasing sums, you know, it creates its own apparent truth for a very considerable period of time. It doesn't go on forever, and whether it has fallout to the whole economy like it probably did in the late 20s, or whether it's just an isolated industry where the or sector where the bubble bursts and it really doesn't affect other values, who knows? But 5 or 10 years from now, you will know. Charlie?
Well, I think the reason we use the phrase wretched excess is that there are wretched consequences. If you mix the mathematics of the chain letter or the Ponzi scheme with some legitimate development like the development of the internet, you are mixing something which is wretched and irrational and has bad consequences with something that has very good consequences. But you know, if you mix raisins with turds, they're still turds.
That's why they have me write the annual report. But so I think we better move on to Sector 3. Way back there?
My name is Thomas May. I'm 10 years old, and I go to basic school in Canfield, California. I have been a shareholder for 2 years. This is my third annual meeting. Here's my question. I know you won't invest in technology companies, but are you afraid that the internet will hurt some of the companies that you do invest in, such as the Washington Post or Wells Fargo? Thank you.
Well, that's an absolutely terrific question. You know, I may turn my money over to you. There's probably no better question we'll get. And I hope Charlie answers in an appropriate vein, considering your age. It's no religious belief that we don't buy into tech companies. We have never found one, as conventionally defined. We've never found one where we think we know enough about what the business will look like in 10 years that we can make a rational decision as to how much we pay now for that business. In other words, we have not been able to find a business where we think we know what that bush will look like in 10 years and how many birds will be in it, so that we know how many birds we can give up today to participate in that future. There will be wonderful things, as Charlie so colorfully explained, that will evolve from many of these companies, but we don't know how to make that decision. And you're absolutely right that we should be thinking all of the time about whether developments in that tech area threaten the businesses that we're in now, how we might counter those threats, how we might capitalize in opportunities because of it. It's a very, very, very important part of business now, and will become more important in the years to come, including many of our businesses. And, for example, you mentioned the Washington Post. Even closer to home, we own a newspaper called the Buffalo News in Buffalo, New York. We own all of that. So we're in a position to make our own decisions of an operating nature as to what we should do in respect to the Internet. And believe me, Stan Lipsey, who's here today, who runs that paper, and I have talked many, many hours, including considerable time yesterday, about what we are doing on the Internet, what we should be doing, what other people are doing, how it threatens us, how we can counter those threats, all of that sort of thing. And newspapers are a category that, in my view, are very threatened by the Internet, because we had an example. The Internet is terrific for delivering information. We have a product, World Book, that's terrific for delivering information. And 15 years ago, print encyclopedias were the best tool, probably, for educating not only young children, but for educating me or Charlie when we wanted to look up on something on a subject. And the World Book is a marvelous product, but it requires chopping down trees, and it requires operating paper mills, and it requires binding and printing, and it requires a delivery of a 70-pound UPS package. And it was put together in a way that was, for 400 or 500 years, the best technique for taking that information and moving it from those who assembled it to those who wanted to use it. And then the Internet changed that in a very major way. So we have seen firsthand and experienced the business consequences of the improvement offered by the Internet in the delivery of information. And newspapers, although not as immediately susceptible to that problem, still face that overpowering factor. When you eliminate the delivery cost, I mean, we pay a significant percentage of our circulation revenue to our carriers, and we pay additional money to the district managers, and we pay for the trucks to deliver the product out, and we pay for huge printing presses and all of that sort of thing. And people do chop down trees in order to give us the raw material to transmit information in Buffalo. You know, about what the Buffalo Bills did yesterday on Sunday with all the details. And now you have the Internet that has virtually no incremental unit cost to anything and can deliver the information instantaneously. So it's a big factor for newspapers. And the newspaper world, in my view, will look very, very, very different in not that many years. And I find it kind of interesting, because the people in the newspaper business are a little schizophrenic about this. They see this, they're afraid of it, they're in almost all cases trying to combat it in some way operationally, but some of them at least continue to go out and buy papers at a price that sort of reflects the economics that used to exist 20 years ago, when it's, to me, it's very clear that it doesn't exist anymore. So they sort of have their billfold, you know, in the past, even though they see the future. And, you know, I think probably they're making mistakes in many cases. All of our businesses, virtually, Coca-Cola will not be affected in any significant way by the Internet. You know, the razor and blade business won't be, although you could dream up things about distribution or so on, but I think that it's very unlikely. But other businesses we have, our insurance business, particularly at Geico, will be very affected by the Internet. Now, that may turn out to be a big advantage to us over time. I wouldn't be surprised if it is. But our retailing businesses are all threatened in one way or another by Internet developments, and there may be some opportunities there, too. But it's a change. It's a change, and it's going to be change in the world, how the world gets entertainment. It's going to be change in the world, how the world gets information. And it is incredibly low cost compared to the most of the methods of conveying entertainment and information now. Charlie?
Well, he asked if we were afraid if the Internet would hurt some of our business, and I think the answer is yes.
I'm learning to appreciate these short answers, though, Boris, the day goes by. I want to thank you for coming to our meeting. Incidentally, you're way ahead of me. I didn't buy my first stock until I was 11, and so you've got a real jump on me, and I wish you well. Okay, Area 4.
Warren and Charlie, good morning. This is Mo Spence, Waterloo, Nebraska. In 1999, Berkshire Hathaway managed to produce a positive gain in net worth of 0.5%. That means that since present management took over 35 years ago, Berkshire Hathaway has realized a positive gain each and every year and produced an average annual gain of 24%. Including the years you ran the Buffett Limited Partnership, you have had a run of 48 consecutive years of positive gains in net worth without one single down year, producing a compounded rate of return of almost 26% annually. On behalf of the long-term shareholders of Berkshire Hathaway, we want to thank you from the bottom of our pocketbooks.
No, thank you. I hope your question isn't going to be whether we can continue that, but go ahead. Do you have a question?
My question is, don't you think you could have ended the millennium with a bigger bang than 0.5%?
Well, I certainly wish we could have, but the interesting thing about those figures, actually the figures go back before that, because the very best period was pre the partnership days, but because the amount I was working with was so small. But there's nothing magic about a one-year period. I mean, it's the way the measurements come out. If you took all the half-year periods, for example, I know that there were a number that were down, you know, and there are going to be lots of years in the future, assuming I live long enough, we will have plenty of down years. It's been a fluke to some degree that we have not had any down years in terms of underlying value. The stock has gone up and down in ways that are not related to intrinsic value a few times. But that is totally a fluke. I mean, we're not going to be up every day. We're not going to be up every week. We're not going to be up every month or even every year. And it's the fact that, you know, the Earth revolves around the sun and really is not totally connected to most business activities. Or the fruition of most investment ideas or anything of the sort. So we have to report every year, and you know, I care about the yearly figures in that sense. I don't really care about them totally as a measure of what we're doing. Like I say, if we could have the capital allocation job that I did in 1999 was very, very poor. And it was partly because some of our main businesses did poorly. I mean, Coca-Cola and Gillette had bad years last year. They'll have good years over time. I wrote a few years ago, it's interesting, I called their soft drink business and their razor and blade business as inevitables. The truth is they've got a higher market share now than they've ever had in history. They're selling more units than any year in history, but certain other factors hurt their business and therefore hurt their stock performance. But I would still call the soft drink, Coca-Cola's position in the soft drink business and Gillette's position in the razor and blade business, I would characterize them as inevitable, that they will gain share over time. Gillette has over 70%. Of the blade and razor business in the world, which is measured by value. You know, that's an extraordinary share. Coke has 50% of the soft drink business in the world. That's well over 1.8 billion servings per day, 1 billion per day. 8% of those are for the account of Berkshire. So over 80 million 8-ounce servings of soft drinks per day are being consumed by people for where the economic benefit comes to Berkshire Hathaway. In effect, we have over 6% for Berkshire Hathaway's account of the blade and razor business in the world, and it'll go up. So I don't worry about the businesses in the least long term. They will have bad years from time to time, and when they do, our performance will not look good in those years. Charlie?
Well, it's been a very interesting stretch. One of the most interesting things about the stretch is that during pretty much the whole period, the company has owned marketable securities in excess of its net worth. And so you have this extraordinary liquidity. in a company that has performed very well to boot. That advantage has not gone away, and in fact, it's been augmented. Give us reasonable opportunities, and we are prepared.
Well, you've heard of what you're supposed to do now. We'll do the rest. Just give us the opportunities. Area 5.
My name is Greg Blevins from Bardstown, Kentucky. I have a question about intrinsic value. It comes from comments that you made in your annual report this year. In there, you described the extraordinary skills of a jet in judging risk. When I think about Berkshire and its ability to increase intrinsic value, it seems to me that judging risk has been at least as important as an ability to calculate a net present value. So my question to each of you is, would you give us some comments on how you think about risk?
Well, we think of business risk in terms of what can happen, say, 5, 10, 15 years from now that will destroy or modify or reduce the economic strengths that we perceive currently exist in a business. And some businesses, it's impossible to figure, at least it's impossible for us to figure, and then we don't even think about it then. We are enormously risk-averse. We are not risk-averse in terms of losing $1 billion if there were an earthquake in California today. And we're thinking of writing a policy, for example, in the next week or so on a primary insurance risk of over $1 billion. That doesn't bother us as long as the math is in our favor. But in terms of doing a group of transactions like that, we are very risk-averse. In other words, we want to think that we've got a mathematical edge in every transaction, and we think that we'll do enough transactions over a lifetime so that no matter what the result of any single one, that the group expectancy gets almost a certainty. When we look at businesses, we try to think of what can go wrong with them. We try to look at businesses that are good businesses now, and we think about what can go wrong with them. If we can think of very much that can go wrong with them, we just forget it. We are not in the business of assuming a lot of risk in businesses. That doesn't mean we don't do it inadvertently and make mistakes, because we do. But we don't intentionally or willingly, voluntarily go into situations where we perceive really significant risks that the business is going to change in a major way. And that gets down to what you probably heard me talk about before, is what kind of a moat is around the business. You know, every business that we look at, we think of as an economic castle. And castles are subject to marauders. And in capitalism, any castle you have, whether it's razor blades or soft drinks or whatever, you have to expect that. I mean, you want the capitalistic system to work in a way that millions of people are out there with capital thinking about ways to take your castle away from you and appropriate it for their own use. And then the question is, what kind of a moat do you have around that castle that protects it? See's Candy has a wonderful moat around its castle. And Chuck Huggins has taken that moat, which he took charge of in 1972, and he has widened that moat every year. He throws crocodiles and sharks and piranhas in the moat, and it gets harder and harder for people to swim across and attack the castle, so they don't do it. If you look since 1972, Forrest Mars tried with FLM, I don't know, 20 years ago, and I hate to think of how much money it cost him to try that. And he was a very experienced businessman. So we think in terms of that moat and the ability to keep its width and its impossibility of being crossed as the primary criterion of a great business. And to our managers, we say we want the moat widened every year. You know, that does not necessarily mean that the profit is more this year than last year, because it won't be sometimes. But if the moat is widened every year, the business will do very well. When we see a moat that's tenuous in any way, it getting back to your question, it's just too risky. We don't know how to evaluate that. and therefore we leave it alone. We think all of our businesses, virtually all of our businesses, have pretty darn good moats, and we think the managers are widening them. Charlie?
How could you say it better?
Here, have some peanut brittle on that one. Okay, six.
Good morning.
Morning.
My name is Hugh Stevenson. I'm a shareholder from Atlanta.
Why don't you open that?
My question involves the company's activities before and shortly after the Gen Re acquisition. I remember you saying once that in insurance, virtually all surprises are negative ones. And I'm wondering, given the company's operating experience in insurance over a long period of time, could you tell us what happened in the Unicover situation? How come with Gen Re's experience and the company's experience that it happened, they didn't foresee it, we didn't foresee it? What has the company done? I know they've taken a large reserve for the situation. And how do they plan to operate in the future to prevent these things, find them out, and strengthen the company from these kind of situations in the future?
Yeah, the Unicover situation was discovered in about, February of last year or thereabouts. And it was a mistake. I mean, it should not have been made. A lot of other people made the same mistake, but that still didn't mean that we should have made that mistake. We set up a reserve of $275 million when the mistake was discovered, and that reserve looks like it's about right still. There have been quite a few developments at Unicover that have defined the limits of it better and resulted in the resolutions of many of the issues attached to it. Still looks like about a $275 million mistake. Now, that's a big mistake. But we've made bigger ones. We had one in the mid-70s that probably cost Berkshire, measuring opportunity cost and everything, because we didn't know how bad it was going to be. I would say that Berkshire would now be worth at least 10% more with that mistake. And Kurt, wouldn't you say so, Charlie? The Omni situation.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So we had a mistake whose present value would be $8 or $9 billion. It cost us at least that.
It cost us less than $4 million at the time.
Yeah. So but we didn't know it was $4 million. So it tied our hands in other respects too. In insurance, you will get surprises. Now, the test of a good management is how many surprises you get. But there's no way you'll get no surprises. And if you look at our history, you will see some years when our float cost us a lot of money. You will also see a history where over 33 or so years that it's been a very, very attractive business. But we have had cases, our name causes problems. I think National Indemnity, we had a fraud, as I remember, down in Texas where an agent was using our paper, which incidentally was the same problem we had, the one that cost us so much. And some guy is out there writing surety bonds on construction of schools. And he says he represents National Indemnity, and the contract proceeds. And, of course, we've never heard of the guy. But if you get a school district in Texas with a half-finished school, and the choice is whether the taxpayers ante up more, or whether you find that this guy had apparent authority as an agent and so on, and therefore we should pay on a policy we never heard of, written by a guy we'd never heard of, on a school we never heard of, we'll end up paying. So the surprises are unpleasant. 9 times out of 10, we'll have more. We had another one last year that shouldn't have happened, but they do happen. And General Re has a terrific record over time. We knew last year would not be a good business in the reinsurance business. It was worse than we thought it would be. But that had nothing to do. I mean, if you told me the figures that General Re would have at the end of the year, we'd have made the same deal in a moment. And we didn't do so well with Coke and Gillette ourselves, so that the ratio of mistakes was probably fairly equal between the two organizations, with me contributing my share. I think insurance which will continue to have surprises in it, will turn out to be a very, very good business for Berkshire over time. It's the best one I know about that we can do in increasing scale over time. As a matter of fact, some of you may not have noticed, but we announced another small insurance acquisition just last week. It's a tough field. The average company is going to do poorly. We think we have some very special companies, and we really do think over time we will acquire and utilize float at a cost that's very, very attractive. It won't be zero like it's been in the past. I mean, we are in some lines of business where intentionally, I mean, we would be crazy to try and hold it to zero, because it's way better to have twice as much money at 1 or 2% as half as much money at 0%. But we will fully acknowledge that, I mean, Unicover was a surprise, but that I don't know how many surprises I've had in insurance over the 33 years or so we've been in it. One of the surprises, incidentally, you know, worked to our incredible benefit. GEICO has been a great, great company since I first went down to Washington, and even before that, and met Lorimer Davidson almost 50 years ago. But they made a mistake in the early 70s that really did bankrupt the company. But fortunately, there was an insurance commissioner named Max Wallach in the District of Columbia who saw that it could be resuscitated. And that mistake enabled us to make many, many billions of dollars. So mistakes can be useful on occasion, too. Charlie?
All that said, it is perhaps the most irritating way to lose money there is to be taken by a sort of obvious lie. But it happens. I don't think it's likely to happen again on that scale.
Well, I wouldn't say that. I would say that it's unlikely to, you know, in any 20-year period or anything like that, we will get a big surprise. And it will come about very often through one form or another of three or four methods of obvious fraud that we've observed in the past. But they spring up again. And there are plenty of people that are, I'd have to say, crooked in insurance, because it's a product where you deliver a piece of paper and somebody hands you money, and that intrigues people. You know, you don't even hand them a dilly bar, you know, or anything in exchange. They hand you a lot of money, and you give them a little piece of paper. And of course, when you get into reinsurance and all that, then you hand that little piece of paper to somebody else and try and get them to hand you money. And all the way along the line, you have brokers who are getting big chunks of money for sort of papering over some of the weaknesses in the project, and sometimes they may even be in on it. So it's a field that attracts chicanery, and often the same people come back again and again. It's amazing to me. So I would say that we will get a surprise or two over any 10-year period in insurance. It's almost impossible to avoid. We should try to minimize it. We do try to minimize it, but I would not want to bet my life that we've seen the last of a Unicover type situation. They're always just a little bit different enough so that it doesn't get spotted, or somebody down the line doesn't get the message. But I don't know. Don't you think, Charlie, we'll see another one?
Well, perhaps so, but it was a long time from one to the other.
Yeah, right.
And maybe I'll be able to get through without another. One of these fraud artists, Warren, caused me to meet years ago, and his proposition was that he had this perfectly marvelous business. He says, "We only write fire insurance on concrete bridges that are underwater." He says, "It's like taking candy from babies." And
we were the babies.
And I looked in his eye, and I thought he was kidding or something. He wasn't kidding. I mean, these people believe this kind of stuff.
The truth is, if Charlie and I could see everybody we dealt with, we would screen out some perfectly honest people, too. I think we could probably screen out the crooked propositions. I mean, they do have similar characteristics to them. And what happens is you get somebody out in the field who is eager to write business or who's being wooed by producers, and the intermediaries get very good at it. It's the same way lousy stocks get sold. I mean, you get people who are getting paid very well to part, you know, separate you from your money. And that's worked over the years. The good salesmen find out they can make more money, selling phony products with big tickets attached to them than they can selling lollipops. Number seven.
Good morning, Mr. Buffett, and good morning, Mr. Munger. My name is Monish Pabrai, and I'm from Long Grove, Illinois. I have been a student and disciple of yourself, Mr. Buffett, for some time, and especially Mr. Munger. And I have adopted quite intensely your theories on capital allocation in the manner in which I run my business as well as my portfolio, and quite pleased with the results so far. My question has to do with the original 1950s Buffett partnerships. There is some conflicting data in the various books about you pertaining to the rules of the partnership and the fees of the partnership. What I wanted to understand is, I think some of the books allude to the principal being guaranteed, I think 6% a year being guaranteed, and then you took a fourth and the partners got three-fourths. In some cases they talk about 4%, in some cases they say there's no guarantee. I would just appreciate a clarification on that.
Okay, we'll make it short because I'm not sure how much general interest there is to that. But there was never any guarantee. There was a guarantee that I wouldn't get a penny myself. There was none of this 1% fee and all that sort of thing that hedge funds now normally have. After a short period of time, I told people I'd have all my capital in it, basically. So there was a guarantee I would follow, have a common destiny. There was never any guarantee of principal of any sort. Originally, the thing started by accident, so that there were 11 different partnerships before they all got put together on January 1st, 1962, into Buffett partnerships. So with the 11 different partnerships, they had some different arrangements based on the preferences of the limited partners. I offered them an option of three or four different choices, and different families made different choices. When we put them together, we settled on the 6% preferential with a quarter of the profits over that, with a carry forward of all deficiencies. Nobody was guaranteed anything on them. Charlie had a much better partnership. His was the third, as I remember, wasn't it, Charlie?
Yes, but we were smaller and operating specialists both on the stock exchange.
Yeah.
Facts were different.
Yeah. Okay, let's go to eight.
Mr. Buffett, Mr. Munger, good morning. My name is Pete Banner, and I'm from Boulder, Colorado. In the 1996 annual report, Mr. Buffett, you stated companies such as Coca-Cola and Gillette might well be labeled the inevitables, and you just reaffirmed your view of Coca-Cola and Gillette. My question to you is, do you have the same view of American Express? That is, do you view American Express as, quote, the inevitable?
Yeah. I'd like to clarify one point, too. I didn't really say I regard the companies as inevitables. I regarded the businesses, their dominance of soft drinks or their competitive strength in soft drinks and in razors and blades. As a matter of fact, I actually pointed out in talking about that a few paragraphs later, I pointed out that the danger of having a wonderful business is the temptation to go into less wonderful businesses. And to some extent, for example, Gillette's stumble in the last year or two has not been the product of their razor and blade business, but it's been some other businesses which are not at all inevitable. And that, that is always a risk, and it's a risk I pointed out, that when a company with a wonderful business gets into a mediocre business, that usually the reputation of the mediocre business prevails over the supposed invincibility of the management of the wonderful business. American Express, an interesting case study, because it does have we always think in terms of share of mind versus share of market, because if share of mind is there, market will follow. People virtually, probably 75% of the people in the world have something in their mind about Coca-Cola. And overwhelmingly, it's favorable. Everybody in California has something in their mind about See's Candy, and overwhelmingly, it's favorable. The job is to have it in a few more California minds, or world minds in the case of Coke, over the years, and have it even be a little more favorable as the years go by. If we have that, everything else follows, and consumer product organizations understand that. American Express had a very special position in people's mind about financial integrity over the years, and ubiquity of acceptance. When the banks closed in the early 30s, American Express traveler's checks actually substituted to some extent for bank activity during that period. The worldwide acceptance of this name meant that when American Express sold traveler's checks, for many years their two primary competitors were what are now Citicorp, First National City, and the Bank of America. And despite the fact that American Express charged you 1% when you bought your traveler's checks, and you had two other premier organizations, Citicorp, imagine, and B of A, and actually Barclays had one, and Thomas Cook had one, and American Express still had two-thirds of the market after 60 or 70 years, two-thirds of the worldwide market, while charging more for the product than these other very well-known competitors charge. Anytime you can charge more for a product and maintain or increase market share against well-entrenched, well-known competitors, you have something very special in people's minds. Same thing came about when the credit card came around. Originally, American Express went into the credit card because they thought they were going to get killed on traveler's checks, and they thought it was going to be a substitute, and therefore they had to go into it. It was a defensive move. It came about because a fellow named Ralph Schneider and Al Bloomingdale and a couple people came up with the Diners Club idea, and the Diners Club idea was sweeping, well, initially New York, and then the country in the mid-50s. And American Express got very worried because they thought, you know, people are going to use these cards. Nobody had ever heard of Visa at that point or anything of the sort, but people were going to use these cards instead of traveler's checks. So they backed into the traveler's check business. I mean, they backed into the credit card business. Immediately, despite the jump that Diners Club had on this business, because Diners Club had the restaurants signed up already, and they already had the high rollers carrying around their card, and nobody had an American Express card. But American Express went in, and they started charging more than Diners Club for the card, and they kept taking market share away. Well, that is a great position to be in people's minds, where they are willing to, when faced with a choice, they're willing to go with a newer product at a higher price and leave behind the entrenched product. And it just showed the power of American Express. American Express had a special cachet. It identified you as something special when you pulled out your American Express card as opposed to your Diners Club card and as opposed to the Carte Blanche card, which was the third main competitor at the time. Visa still did not exist. And you could see this dominance prevail. That told you what was in people's minds. It's why I bought into the stock in 1964. We bought 5% of the company for a huge investment at the time for us. I was only managing $20 million at the time. But you could see that this share of mind, this consumer franchise, had not been lost. In the considerable period of time, American Express got into other businesses. They got into Fireman's Fund Insurance, was a very big acquisition. And to some extent, they let the Visas of the world and all of those get established. They still had this preeminent cachet position, but it was eroding. But I would say that Harvey Golub, along with a lot of other people in the management, have done an extremely good job of reaffirming, intensifying the cachet. There will be probably $300 billion worth of charges, something in that area, put on American Express this year. The $300 billion, those are big numbers even in today's world. The average discount fee is about 2.73%. If you look at the average discount fee on Visa, MasterCharge, you know, it's going to be probably a full percentage point beneath that. So you've got a percentage point on $300 billion, which is $3 billion of revenue that your competitor doesn't get. You can do a lot of things for your clientele. And they've segmented the card, as you know. They've even recently gone to this black card. and which sells for $1,000. And it's got a very special cachet. I would say that, I wouldn't use the word inevitable, but I would say that nourished properly, that the American Express name has had, excuse me, has huge value and is very, very likely to get stronger and stronger as the years go by. But I think that what they went through showed that it could take quite a beating and come back, but I don't think you'd want to test it that way indefinitely. Incidentally, that's one of the things we look for in businesses is how, if you see a business take a lot of adversity and still do well, that tells you something about the underlying strength of the business. The classic case on that was, to me, is AOL. 4 or 5 years ago, I'm no expert on this, but I got the impression there for a period of time when they were having a lot of problems that a very significant percentage of AOL's customers were mad at them. But the number of customers went up every month. And that's a terrific business. I mean, if you have a business where your customers are mad at you and you're growing, that has met a certain test, in my mind, of utility. And you might argue that American Express had that to some degree. It wasn't that bad, but they had a lot of merchant unrest and all of that. So occasionally you will find that an interesting test of the strength of a business. Coca-Cola had some problems, in Europe, but it comes back stronger than ever. They certainly had problems with New Coke, and they came back stronger than ever. So you do see that underlying strength. And that's very impressive as a way of evaluating the depth and impenetrability of the moat that we talked about earlier. Charlie?
Well, I think it would be easier to screw up American Express than it would Coke or Gillette. But it's an immensely strong business. And it's wonderful to have it.
We own about 11% of American Express, so when there are $300 billion of charges, we're getting $33 billion of those for the account of Berkshire, and it's growing at a pretty good clip. The first quarter it grew very substantially, and both cardholders and charges. And my guess is that our 11% becomes more valuable over time. It's hard to think of anything that would destroy it.
The business is very interesting. They made a deal to put American Express cards into Costco. I think that is a very intelligent thing for American Express to have done. And it's a very aggressive place that does a lot of interesting things.
Charlie is a director of Costco, so he's Costco is an absolutely fabulous organization. We should have owned a lot of Costco over the years, and I blew it. Charlie was for it, but I blew it. Okay, we'll go to number one.